Last time we beat Arsenal without Casemiro, and so we have a squad, and so we have to fill that gap and make a proper plan, and the squad have to fill it and make sure that there is a team. We already showed how to beat Arsenal.
Listen, what's going on, people? It is the 3-pointers TV. We are back out here, like
back taking 3 points at the Emirates again.
That's it, man. Big up Dubs, big up States. Listen, Arsenal 3, Man United 2. My voice is gone, mate. Listen, let's get straight into it. Marty, tell me, man. Talk to me.
Mate,
talk to me.
This is what football games are made for. 90th minute winners at the Emirates, and that place went absolutely bananas. Absolutely crazy. What a game. What a game. And do you know what the maddest thing is? There's four people in front of me that left on 80 minutes after they heard the tube announcement.
Yeah.
And I thought, imagine, I said to some people next to me, I said, imagine we score a 90th minute winner. Wow. I said, what happens? And this place goes, and missing out on that. And it always shows, stay till the end.
The place erupted.
What's ever happened to Fergie time?
That's all disappeared. Listen though, first half, let's talk about the first half. Man United, they went 1-0 up.
Yep.
Rashford, what a brilliant goal. Fantastic goal from him.
Do you know what? That was completely against the run of play. And do you know what? As soon as they picked the ball up, I think Partey got nutmegged, which he never does, and then completely against the run of play, Rashford stuck an absolute cracker in the bottom corner.
Fantastic.
And that's all you can say. The finishing was absolutely sublime, and, you know, fair play to him. It was against the run of play. But what I love about this Arsenal team is the resilience, and then that leads you on to the second goal. Yeah. And look, Eddie Nketiah, I can hardly speak. My voice is absolutely mulled.
Before we go into that, mate, because obviously the first 5-10 minutes we was all over them, but then somehow Man United were really pushing to get, you know, to get the first goal, and that's what happened.
Yeah,
we talk about that. I mean, because it kind of looked a bit like it's going to be one of those games where Man United look like the better side. They look like the better side.
Yeah, United turned up in parts, and they looked dangerous. And I think we looked a little bit shaky in parts where you thought this could go the other way, but we kept on coming back.
Yeah.
And and that's the resilience. And then obviously we equalise. I think it was within 4 or 5 minutes. And that sets the tone. And then the Emirates really got going.
Yeah.
And then I think we went 2-1 up, didn't we?
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
I can hardly, the whole thing's a blur to me. It's absolute chaos.
Buzzing.
And then we've gone, and then obviously they equalised. But that's Saka goal.
That's
finishing. Beating a world-class goalkeeper like David De Gea from outside the penalty area like that shows the level of finishing.
Yeah.
These three front players that we have, imagine what they're like. Well, you know what they're like now. Imagine what these guys are going to be like in 2-3 years. It's scary. The finishing of Saka, Nketiah, and all the people that jumped on Eddie's back a while ago. Now, he's just popped up in a big game and scored two huge goals.
Yeah.
Huge. Do not underestimate. That goal there, that 19th minute winner, was absolutely... And then Mikhailo Mud, who? Yeah. Listen, everyone's saying, oh, I missed out on that signing. But listen, Trossard, when he came on, he looked just as dangerous as Mudrick, if not. He's a proven Premier League player. Listen, these guys know what they're doing at the back. The top of the league. When have we ever been consistently top of the league like this? Also, Man City won the earlier kickoff. So they knew that they'd close the gap to 2 points.
Yeah.
And this is what teams do. Championship winning sides will see that gap close with the earlier kickoff. And that's how Sky and what have you do it for this entertainment.
Yeah.
And then we've gone and put in a performance like that and got the 3 points.
I think this should send a message to everybody out there, because for some reason, people just feel like Arsenal are gonna sort of, they're feeling some sort of pressure, but we keep telling the press, you know, that we're just taking it game by game. We're really focused.
Listen, there's no pressure at the top of the mountain, mate. The air is clean at the top of the mountain. The breeze is fresh. Don't worry about that. Listen, people need to stop writing this Arsenal team off because they've shown consistently that things happen in championship title challenges. Yeah. Can it happen? Listen, we're not Spurs. We're not Tottenham Hotspur. No. This is Arsenal Football Club. It's a completely different team. We've bought really well. And we have quality players. That last 25 minutes at that Emirates, we were all over Manchester. Yes. That Manchester, I remember, go back to the first Leicester video, and I said about Erik ten Hag, I said about ten Hag coming in, and people thought, oh man, you're written off, they're going to be useless again. And I said, he'll organise them, he'll bring in some great players. And don't forget, they were without Casemiro, who is, you know, arguably one of the best CDMs in the Premier League.
Yeah.
He's a fantastic player, he's a true winner, and you know, this United side is a really good footballing side.
So that leads me to ask you another question though, Marty. Do you think they struggle to get without Casemiro?
Definitely. And that was, I think, the quality, the drive, and at times, you know, at the end, Manchester United let us camp out in their penalty area, and we were just literally pinging the ball around and just carrying, and the goal was going to come. It was always going to happen. And this Emirates crowd, this place is electric. It is nuts.
The atmosphere is just been
it's unreal. It's a different level.
It's a different feeling right now.
Different level.
Right from the start of the season.
Right from the get go. And these big games that you've got, you know, this crowd, these big games. This is a scary place for teams to come now. Back in, you know, a good few years ago, this was a place where the atmosphere was terrible, you know, and there was a lot of bad stuff. It's very toxic. And now this place, it's the home of football, and it is unreal.
Do you think now, after this game, especially the game we had last week against the Dutty Spurs?
Yeah, definitely.
Do you think now people, not even just Arsenal fans, but just general footballing wise, the footballing nation?
I think until we actually win it, that's when people really, really stand up and be like, for the next season, okay, this is a team to be reckoned with, and what Mikel Arteta and this team are producing and doing. I think that's the truth of this, and I make that right, because until we win it, it's not won, right? But this team is, what it's showing is resilience. The amount of games we come from behind, we draw level, and then we go on and win games. We're picking up points. This, by the way, this is the only team that we've just played, the only team that beat us this entire Premier League campaign. Team's doing better than the Invincibles. There's a lot of statistics that prove that how well this team's doing. I think buying Trossard was a shrewd piece of business, because he's a proven Premier League player. He scored 7 goals in 16 games, and you know, that's playing for Brighton. Don't forget, when you're playing for Brighton, you might get 2 or 3 chances a game. When you're playing for Arsenal Football Club, you're going to get chances. Yes. You're going to get 5, 6, 7, 8. You know, you're going to get chances as a forward player, and you know, they know what they're doing. He's a more experienced player that they've bought in. And when you're going for title charges, you need those older heads. And they've said, is this team too young? Well, he's just bought in a 28-year-old. So what are you saying now? He's bought, you know, a defender as well. And there's talk of Kavinga coming, which would be a world-class, experienced signing.
22 years old. Made an appearance in the World Cup recently.
There you go, and that's what you've got to look at with this Arsenal team. But coming to days like this and games like this, and scoring winners in the 90th minute, and how that place goes, that is what, not just football, that's what life's about. That was a life experience right there, and it was absolutely unbelievable. Just like to say, big shout out to my daughter Honey. Unfortunately,
she wasn't here today.
Yeah. She's my little mate that comes along with me and watches with me, but she couldn't make it. She's at her mother-in-law's, she should hopefully be coming on the next game. So it'll be good to see her.
Nice one, mate. And listen, man, next Premier League game is up against Everton. How do you see that going?
Is that next one?
I'm sure that's the next one. We've got Brentford. Man City obviously in the cup. We've got Man City in the cup on Friday.
Brentford?
We've got Everton.
Everton, okay. Is it Everton? Yeah. Look, do you know what? I see a video of Frank Lampard earlier, and he looks like a broken man. I feel for him. I mean, but listen, all the shit he used to give everyone, you know, he's getting it back. I think, you know, I don't know how long he's going to be left in a job. I hope he don't get sacked before the Arsenal game. And listen, you've got to say, they're going to come here and we're going to absolutely batter them. Come on! Come on!
Yeah!
Come on! That's what it's like around the Emirates right about now. So, you know, that Everton team, if they come here and play like how they've been playing, they're going to get absolutely battered. Like, I feel for them, and I feel for Frank Lampard, because that will probably be the game that he loses his job, and that's as simple as that. That's going to be the game that he probably will lose his job. Right. We've got Brentford coming up as well. Yeah. You know, we've got City coming up. We've got the midweek game against City. We beat City and we nicked 3 points off of them.
We've done the January business, and then we do
Brentford and Everton. That's 9 points, and we'll then be 11 points in front of City. That's if they don't slip up. And I've spoken about this. I think City, Pep Guardiola wants that Champions League, and our opportunity to win this title is focusing on the Premier League. To be honest, the Europa League, would it be good to win that? Of course it would. I wouldn't turn down with the FA Cup. I respect the FA Cup. It's a huge trophy, a trophy that I really respect from being a child. But the Premier League is what we need to win to really set precedent about who we are. So, you know, focusing on that, we have our starting 11. The only thing is obviously a bit of depth that we could slightly struggle with potentially. If we was to get injuries to maybe the likes of Partey, Xhaka, Odegaard, you know, it's shown. I don't think Vieira's quite there to perform at that level. I mean, Odegaard's probably one of, you know, this team are the best team in the Premier League, and the levels they perform at are unbelievable. So that's the only thing. But I think the focusing on the Premier League and getting this wrapped up, because City are going to be well wrapped up in Champions League situations. So, you know, that there's going to be no better opportunity for us to win the Premier League than this season because of where City are at.
Fantastic, mate. Listen, Marty, thank you so much, my
brother. Nice to see you, man. Nice to see you.
That is why we're called the three-pointers.
Because we come and get 3 points. Come on.
Last time we beat Everton, Arsenal without Casemiro. And so we have a squad. And so we have to fill that gap and make a proper plan. And the squad have to fill it and make sure that there is a team. We already showed how to beat Arsenal.